Experiment 9 in Chem 1310 is titled Calorimetry, Heats of Reaction, and Hess's Law. The basic goal of this experiment is to use the technique of calorimetry to determine delta H values, or enthalpy changes, of reaction. The interest in determining delta H's goes beyond just our theoretical interest in thermodynamics. There are quite a few practical applications here. Delta H tells us, under constant pressure conditions, whether a reaction will absorb or release heat. And so, if we'd like to apply a reaction to heating or cooling applications, we need to understand its delta H before we can move forward with that in a rational way. Additionally, we can use known delta H's to determine unknown delta H's using Hess's law. At its core, Hess's law really just says that enthalpy is a state function. But the simple statement that enthalpy is a state function has very profound implications. Specifically, it means that as long as we can identify a path in chemical space to convert reactants to products, if we know all of the enthalpies along that path, we can simply add them up to produce the enthalpy for the overall conversion of reactants to products. So reactions that are very difficult to study can be broken down into simpler reactions that are easier to study, and then the enthalpies of those simpler reactions that we can measure can be added to produce the unknown enthalpy. Let's begin with some basic principles of calorimetry. So the essential device for any calorimetry experiment is called a calorimeter. That's a fancy term for a well-insulated vessel containing a thermometer or other temperature measuring device that allows us to measure the temperature of the contents inside. Inside the calorimeter, we place a solution of the reactants for the reaction we'd like to study. For us, this so-called bath solution will consist of water and hydrochloric acid, and that solution will surround the magnesium or magnesium oxide reactant. Ideally, the walls of a calorimeter are a perfect insulator. This means that no heat can escape the inside of the calorimeter. This keeps our setup fairly well controlled and allows us to easily understand how heat flows within the calorimeter. Namely, any heat that the reactants absorb en route to forming products has to come from the water bath. And conversely, any heat that the reactants release has to be released into the water bath. So changes in the temperature of the water bath tell us about the heat released or absorbed by the reaction. Let's now put a quantitative spin on this idea. So let's imagine that the red and black dots that you see in solution inside the calorimeter there react to form a product in which the two have bonded to one another. We can ask about the change in enthalpy associated with this reaction, and as we'll see shortly, calorimetry can be used to directly measure this delta H. To see this quantitatively, let's start with the first law of thermodynamics, which says that the change of internal energy associated with the change from reactants to products is equal to Q, the heat released or absorbed by the reaction, plus W, the work done by the reaction or on the reaction by the surroundings. This is just the first law of thermodynamics. Now, our calorimeter will be open to the air, and what that means is that we're under constant pressure conditions, the constant pressure being the pressure imposed by the atmosphere. So the work associated with the change is equal to negative P delta V, the negative pressure times the change in volume. If we substitute this in to the equation for the first law, we arrive at delta U equals Q minus P delta V, and a little bit of rearranging gets us to Q is equal to delta U plus P delta V. Now, since pressure is constant, that means delta P equals zero, which means that the right-hand side corresponds to the change in overall state function that equals U plus PV, or what we call enthalpy. So the right-hand side of that equation is equal to delta H, the change in enthalpy. And what this equation on the right says in words is that under constant pressure conditions, the heat absorbed or evolved by the reaction is equal to the change in enthalpy. Now, this is nice, but this sort of begs the question, how do we measure this heat absorbed or evolved by the chemical reaction? Well, for one thing, if we're thinking of the calorimeter as a perfect insulator, all the heat, say, released by the reaction has to be absorbed by the surrounding water bath. So if we can somehow measure the heat flow to or from the surrounding water bath, we can get back to delta H for the reaction that's occurring. The key to that is Q is equal to C times M times delta T. This is essentially the definition of specific heat. So the specific heat of a particular substance is defined as the amount of heat required to raise 1 gram of the substance 1 degree Celsius. So it's measured and reported in joules per gram degree C. It's the number of joules, the amount of heat, required to raise 1 gram of the substance 1 degree C. Notice that the other two factors in this equation are just the mass in grams and the change in temperature, which is measured in degrees C. So when we multiply through on the right-hand side, we find that the units left are joules, and this is indeed the unit of heat. Using this equation, Q equals C times M times delta T, we can use the delta T of the water bath to calculate Q, and this amount of heat is the negative of the heat released or absorbed by the reaction, since all of the heat released by the reaction must be absorbed by the surrounding water bath. For our experiment in particular, this is one of the reactions we'll study. 1 mole of magnesium metal reacting with 2 moles of hydrochloric acid to form magnesium chloride and hydrogen gas. The reaction will take place inside of a water bath within a calorimeter, and so we'll be able to relate the heat absorbed or released by the water bath to the delta H of the reaction that's occurring within that bath. So far, we've talked about calorimeters as if they're perfect insulators. However, no calorimeter in practice is a perfect insulator, and that means there will always be heat flow to or from the walls of the calorimeter in the course of a reaction or any sort of temperature change that's occurring inside. To account for this, we need to do a calibration procedure in which we determine the number of joules absorbed or released by the walls of the calorimeter per degree C change in temperature. To perform the calibration procedure, we'll start with 50 grams of water at a cold temperature TC. This will typically be room temperature, around 20 degrees C. And we'll introduce that to the calorimeter and wait a little bit so that the walls of the calorimeter and the cold water come to thermal equilibrium. Both of them will be at TC. Simultaneously, we'll heat up 50 grams of water in a separate container until it reaches a temperature T sub H. And then we'll introduce the hot water to the cold water inside the calorimeter. To gain some insight into the calorimeter's role in heat flow, we can ask about the final temperature of the water after mixing. Theoretically, the temperature after mixing should be T sub H plus T sub C divided by 2. This expression may look a little bit cryptic until you realize that this is just the average of the two temperatures, and it's the halfway point between the hot and cold water temperatures. This makes sense from an ideal perspective, because if no heat is being lost to the calorimeter walls, then the hot water should cool down by the same amount that the cold water heats up. So the hot water will decrease to the halfway point, and the cold water will increase to the halfway point, ideally, assuming there's no heat transfer to or from the calorimeter walls. In practice, what we find is that the final temperature is less than this ideal halfway point. To explain this, we can invoke a model in which there's the expected heat transfer from the hot water to the cold water, but there's also heat transfer from the hot water to the walls of the calorimeter. And so the calorimeter walls heat up slightly and absorb some heat in the process. To once again put a quantitative spin on this, we can now imagine that the heat released by the hot water, QH, is equal to the negative of the heat absorbed by the cold water plus the heat absorbed by the calorimeter. So I've written that here as negative Q sub H equals Q sub C plus Q cal. We can then unpack each of these Qs into their corresponding MC delta T expressions. So negative MC delta TH equals MC delta TC plus C cal times delta T cal. And here the C cal constant, called the calorimeter constant, is exactly the joules per degree C that we're looking for. How much heat is absorbed by the calorimeter per degree C change in temperature? This is called, in broader terms, the heat capacity of a substance, the joules required to raise the temperature of the substance by 1 degree C. Here, the M and C in black are the mass of the water, 50 grams, times C, the specific heat of water, 4.184 joules per gram degree C. Doing a little bit of rearranging and dividing through by delta T cal allows us to isolate C cal. The hot, cold, and final temperatures will all be measured, so we'll have all we need on the left-hand side to calculate C cal. And we'll do this for 3 different trials and average the results to determine an overall calorimeter constant with average and standard deviation. A couple of things to think about during the calibration phase of this experiment. For one, ask yourself, what is delta T cal? We haven't really specified that. What is delta T cal? Keep in mind that the calorimeter is in thermal equilibrium with the cold water at the start of the experiment, and at the end of the experiment, the calorimeter is in thermal equilibrium with both components mixed. That'll give you insight into the value for delta T cal. Secondly, ask yourself what happens when the calorimeter constant is equal to zero. What situation does that correspond to, and how does the equation we've written on the left simplify to give us a result that's fairly straightforward? Now let's clarify a little bit how we actually measure enthalpy changes of reaction inside a calorimeter. So we have the reactants inside a bath solution, and they either release or absorb heat to the surrounding bath solution so that the heat absorbed or released by the reacting substances, Q here in red, is equal to the negative m, the mass of the bath solution, times C, its specific heat, times delta T, the measured change in temperature of the bath solution. This is equal to the delta H for the reaction, again assuming that the calorimeter is a perfect insulator and that we're under constant pressure conditions. Delta T will be measured. It's measured by the thermometer inside the calorimeter. Note that Q is heat flow in the opposite direction. This is where the negative sign comes from. If the temperature of the bath solution increases, we can of course imagine that the bath solution is absorbing heat, but that means that the reacting species inside the solution are releasing heat, and so Q in that case would be negative. Now, the delta H value that we get through this measurement process depends on the number of reacting molecules inside the bath solution. In other words, delta H is extensive. It's a quantity that depends on the number of reaction events or the number of moles of reactants present. Put another way, if we have more reactant molecules, here more red dots, then we should expect a greater Q, greater magnitude of Q, either greater absorption or greater release of heat by the reacting species. Extensive enthalpy changes aren't that useful, because unless we have a sense of how many moles were around, we don't know what amount to use to achieve a particular heat absorption or release. An intensive delta H would be a lot more useful. To divide out the dependence of delta H on the number of moles of reacting species, we can divide delta H by one of these numbers of moles, and this is called the molar enthalpy change, or molar delta H. Note that the units of molar enthalpy change are now joules per mole, joules per mole of reacting species, or joules per mole of reaction events. And in our particular case, because the stoichiometric coefficient of magnesium is 1 and magnesium is a limiting reagent under our conditions, we'll divide by the number of moles of magnesium to determine the molar enthalpy change for the reaction of magnesium with HCl. Now you may be asking yourself at this point, what good is this molar delta H value? What can it do for me? Well, there are two big things it can do for you. From delta H, on the one hand, we can use it for practical applications. Will this reaction warm me up or cool me down? The sign of delta H tells you what will happen, and the magnitude of delta H tells you how efficient the reaction is in a way at absorbing or releasing heat. Very large delta H's means you need relatively small numbers of moles of reactants to achieve large heat flows. Secondly, having a delta H value in hand allows you to calculate other delta H's by combining them and applying Hess's law. Next, we'll turn our attention to seeing how that works. Beneath all the complexity of Hess's law is the simple statement that enthalpy is a state function. And to demonstrate what a state function is and why it's useful, I'm going to use a little analogy of temperature and a road trip. So imagine you were taking a road trip between Atlanta and Athens, and you had various routes to choose from. Here are three routes, for example. And imagine you were interested in the change in temperature in going from Atlanta to Athens for each of these routes. Now let's assume that the temperature is constant within each city, but the temperature between cities can vary. So the delta T's may not be zero, but the temperature's not changing with time. In that case, no matter what route we take, we'll get the same change in temperature. Delta T1 is equal to delta T2 is equal to delta T3. And they're all equal just to the difference in temperature between Athens and Atlanta, or TATH, the temperature in Athens, minus TATL, the temperature in Atlanta. In this example, temperature is intrinsic to the state of Atlanta or Athens. It's what's called a state function. We can assign a particular value of T to the state of being in Atlanta and the state of being in Athens. So ultimately, in this example, temperature is a state function. Now let's imagine we added another city to the map with a corresponding delta T from Athens to Macon now of delta T 4. We can now ask, what's the overall temperature change in going from Atlanta to Macon? And if we knew delta T 4 and we didn't want to make the drive all the way from Atlanta to Macon, we could still calculate the overall change in temperature in going from Atlanta to Macon. Intuitively, we know that it's the difference in temperature between Atlanta and Macon. But notice also that we can simply add up delta T1 and delta T4 to get the overall change in temperature in going from Atlanta to Macon. In place of delta T1, of course, we could use delta T2 or delta T3, since both of those are equal to delta T1. This additivity of changes in state functions is extremely useful when dealing with enthalpies. Consider the hypothetical reaction shown here. Solid carbon reacts with oxygen gas to form carbon dioxide, CO2. Imagine we wanted to determine the delta H for this process, but we couldn't study the reaction directly. Instead, we could only study reactions that net, when added together, give this reaction and determine their delta H's. In fact, we can use these component reactions to determine the overall delta H for the process you see here. For example, imagine that we took the reactants and we simply split apart the 1 mole of oxygen atoms into half a mole of oxygen and another half a mole of oxygen. This doesn't really correspond to any sort of chemical change, but now imagine we take the half mole of O2 and react it with the carbon to form carbon monoxide. That leaves us with carbon monoxide and the other half of O2 that we didn't react. Now imagine in a separate reaction step, we took that and combined the carbon monoxide with the half mole of O2 to give carbon dioxide. There's an enthalpy change associated with each of the blue steps. And if we add together the enthalpy changes associated with those steps, we'll get the overall enthalpy change in going from C plus O2 to CO2. This is the useful application of Hess's law, the additivity of enthalpies. So the enthalpy change for splitting apart the 1 mole of oxygen into half a mole of O2 and another half a mole is zero, because all we're really doing is just rewriting the reactants in a different way. But the reaction of carbon with that half mole of oxygen does have a finite delta H. We'll call that delta H1. The reaction of carbon monoxide with the other half mole of oxygen is a separate reaction, and that has its own delta H, delta H2. Let's call the overall delta H for the reaction of carbon with 1 mole of oxygen to form CO2, delta H3. And now, by analogy to the sort of road trip example above, we can see that delta H3 is equal to the sum of the delta H's in blue, 0 plus delta H1 plus delta H2. Hess's law even extends beyond additivity. We can scale and reverse known reactions when trying to determine the enthalpy of an unknown reaction. When you scale a reaction, make sure to scale its enthalpy too, because enthalpy is an extensive quantity, so if we double the number of moles, we need to double the corresponding enthalpy. When you reverse a reaction, negate its enthalpy. If a reaction in the forward direction, say, releases heat, then the corresponding reverse reaction must absorb heat.